Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is April 23rd, 2017. This is the second Sunday after Easter. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. St. John's has an 8 o'clock and a 10:30 service every Sunday. Starting Memorial Day weekend, our 8 o'clock service will be at the Melody Cruise Drive-In Theater on East 40 National Road of Springfield. A 10:30 service will be in the sanctuary downtown. There is a Wednesday night service in the chapel at 6:30 every Wednesday. Communion is the first and third Sunday of the month and every Wednesday evening. St. John's has a outreach store where you can find clothes, small appliances, and assorted sundries. Food pan, it's open Monday through Friday, closed on Thursdays, 9:30 to 1. Food pantries every Wednesday, 9 to 10:45.
Good morning. And welcome to our worship service this morning as we celebrate the second Sunday of Easter. This being a non-communion Sunday, you will need your worship book for the entire service. All the liturgy and so forth is in the worship book. It's not printed like last week in the bulletin. So you'll need the bulletin to know which pages to turn to, but you'll need the hymnal for everything. So now I ask that you turn to page 94 in the front of your worship book to the order of confession and forgiveness, and I invite those who can do so without difficulty to please stay. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom our hearts are open, our desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are tempted to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. Let us now sing hymn number 377, Hallelujah, Jesus is Risen. Hymn number 377 in the back.
Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church. Our first hymn is Alleluia, Jesus is Risen. This is the second Sunday of the Easter season. Jesus is risen, he has risen indeed. This hymn was written by Herbert Brookering, born in 1926. More modern hymn, Alleluia, Jesus is Risen. We can now sing the Alleluias. We can rejoice that we have eternal life. Jesus died for us. He entered the grave. He showed us what to do.
Jesus is risen.
Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
For you will not my soul to Hades, or let your Holy One experience corruption. You have made known to me the ways of life. You will make me full of gladness with your presence. Fellow Israelites, I may say to you confidently of our ancestor David that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Since he was a prophet, he knew that God had sworn with him, with an oath to him, that he would put one of his descendants on the throne. Foreseeing this, David spoke of the resurrection of the Messiah, saying, he was not abandoned to Hades, nor did his flesh experience corruption. This Jesus God raised up, and of that all of us are witnesses. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Becky Demetrov will do the Psalms.
Now time for the gospel being read by our pastor, Pastor John Pollock. We can now sing the Alleluias, as this is the second Sunday of Easter. Alleluias return. We did not sing Alleluias during Lent, but now we have Alleluias again. Alleluia, we are turning to you, Lord. We'll be tested, but we know that we will come out with you, Jesus.
Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven you. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand at his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hand. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that in believing you may have life in his name. The Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. A couple of quick announcements. First of all, thanks to Harvey and Sally and all the kitchen crew and those who helped with Easter breakfast last week. Thanks to all of you who attended and participated in the breakfast. Also, as I mentioned last week, the drive-in will be open. So the 8 o'clock service will move to the drive-in. On Memorial Day weekend, when I say the drive-in will be open for us. It won't be open for showing movies. But again, we will be able to use the drive-in. So Memorial Day, the 8 o'clock service, Memorial Day weekend, the 8 o'clock service will move out to the Melody drive-in. So those who participate in the setting up and so forth need to get together and go out to the drive-in, check the shed, look over them, see what tires need to be reinflated, any of the steps need to be repaired, or anything needs to be painted. So we need to be doing that in the next couple of weeks. Now I ask that you give your attention to the choir.
Special music from our choir, directed by Vicki Perks.
Thank you.
This time you may take out your sermon notes for today as we examine the Easter hope as St. Peter describes it in our second reading in verses 3 through 5 of that first chapter. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. In our celebration of Easter last week, we learned that because Jesus is risen and alive, we know that life is still worth living, that the future can be faced, and that death can be handled. Today, as I mentioned with this second reading of St. Peter, we learn about the hope of Easter, the hope that comes to us because Jesus is risen and alive. So let us again look at verses 3 through 5 of this first chapter of St. Peter's first letter. He begins by saying, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." So the first thing we learn about our Easter hope is that we are born into a living hope, a hope that is real, a hope that is not imaginary, a hope that is not whistling past the graveyard, a hope that is not like when we're a little kid and we hope to receive this toy or that toy for our birthday or Christmas, or when we were a teenager and we had a favorite group or groups and we hoped that they would come to our town and put on a concert and hope that we would be able to purchase tickets for that concert. Those were all just kind of hope based on nothing concrete. This is a living hope. This is real hope. St. Peter begins by saying we should bless God the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. For blessed be God the Father of the Lord Jesus Christ. This word translated blessed means to speak well of someone. It means to celebrate them with praise. It is a Greek word from which we derive our English word eulogy. When you go to a celebration of one's life, someone usually or oftentimes will stand up and give a eulogy. They will talk about the person in personal terms. How much that person meant to them and the effect they had on their life and how outstanding they were. Well, that is speaking well of someone. And St. Peter is instructing us that as followers of Jesus Christ, we are to speak well of God in our lives because of this great gift that God has given to us, this living hope. The word mercy, according to his great mercy, that word literally means compassion. So St. Peter is telling us it is out of God's compassion that he has done all these things on our behalf. Sent his Son into the world to reveal God, what God was really like through the ministry of our Lord Jesus Christ. Sending his Son to the cross to take upon himself the sins of the world, to offer his blood as a final and complete sacrifice so that the sins of the world would be paid for, so that we, by believing in him, have forgiveness of those sins we commit. Then raising his Son on that third day to show that he was indeed the Messiah, the Son of God, the Savior of the world. And then 40 days later, having him ascend bodily into heaven to sit at the right hand of the Father until he comes again to judge the living. So this is all done out of God's compassion. As we see Jesus and read of the ministry of Jesus, we see Jesus revealing a very compassionate, loving Father. Either through actions that Jesus does or through the many parables that he tells. Now, I challenge you to study the religions of the world and see the kind of God that is portrayed in the many of the religions of the world. Many religions, God is indifferent. God seems to care not a bit about what is going on earth. God, in many religions, seems to have no concern whether or not you make it into paradise or not. He just seems totally unconcerned. Something I've shared with you before is when I was serving Hopeful Lutheran Church in Florence, Kentucky. We had a couple in the congregation. The man had been in the Army Corps of Engineers and then retired from active duty and became a civilian employee of the Army Corps of Engineers. And he was sent to Saudi Arabia. And so he was ahead of some projects that the U.S. government was doing in relation to the Saudis. And the thing that surprised him or stunned him was that you could not get the Saudi workers to do any of the just normal safety precautions that we do on the job. They wouldn't wear hard hats. And when they would try to explain to them the purpose of wearing a hard hat to protect you in case something fell, their response was, if somebody above them knocked off a wrench and it fell and hit them in the head and killed them, that was Allah's will. And so they shouldn't do anything to interfere with Allah's will. So they wouldn't wear hard hats. They wouldn't wear a safety belt. They wouldn't wear a safety harness. They wouldn't wear goggles to protect their eyes. All these safety precautions that we do to make common sense. Hey, if it's Allah's will, like the wind comes and blows me off a 20 feet high girder in the air, then that's Allah's will. And I'm doing His will as I fly through the air and splat on the ground below. But our God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the God, the Father, the Creator of the world in which we live, He is a compassionate God. And He has given us this earth in which to live, which has for us all that we need for food and shelter. He has given us intelligence so that we can continue to advance and discover, make more discoveries in order to make jobs more safe and more secure. He gives us the intelligence to discover more and more vaccines and antibiotics and so forth so that we can live healthier lives. That is our God. God who is compassionate. So compassionate that He sent His Son into the world, not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through Him. He tells us that in this living hope we are born again. This word means basically regeneration, referring to the new life we have through our baptism into Jesus Christ. That is God, who through Christ sends to us the sacrament of baptism for the church. So that when we are baptized in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, we are adopted by God as one of His children. We become a child of the Heavenly Father, an heir to the kingdom, a brother and sister of our Lord Jesus Christ. And so this is why we speak well of God. And then it's this living hope. The word hope, the Greek word that means a firm conviction. It means to trust in, to have confidence in. It means not wishful thinking. It's not that you're wishing you would have this hope. This hope is a reality. It's concrete. Jesus won it all for us because He's risen and alive. Because He suffered and died first, and now He's risen and alive, we have this living hope given to us that first Easter. Next, St. Peter says in verse 4 that we have an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you. I'm reading from the English Standard Version, so it may differ a little bit with the New Revised Standard that you have in your insert, but the word should be somewhat similar. So the second thing that comes with the Easter hope is that we have an inheritance. We are familiar with inheritance. Inheritance is something that goes on in human life. Family member passes away, you inherit this is God's plan of salvation. It means a secure possession, that it is something that cannot be taken away from us. It's also the Greek word that is used when you translate the Old Testament from Hebrew and Aramaic into Greek. This is a word that is used for the promised land. So basically what St. Peter is saying is that we have received a hope that includes the promised land. Eternity. The kingdom of heaven. The kingdom of our Lord Jesus Christ. The kingdom of God. That land that is fair in the day, which by faith we can see from afar. That far side back of Jordan. That great getting up morning. That's what its inheritance is. And it is an inheritance that is permanent and forever. It cannot perish. That word means to be immortal, or to be literally unravaged by an invading army. Of course, the people to whom St. Peter was writing were familiar to invading armies. They were subjects of the Roman Empire. They had seen the Roman legions come into their country and ravage it, and carry off the spoils of war back to Rome. But this inheritance, no army can invade and ravage. It cannot spoil, it means it is pure and unpolluted. It amazes me every time I cross the Ohio River, back home to Kentucky, that when the first Europeans came to this country, you could actually drink out of the Ohio River. I wouldn't even put my foot in the Ohio River today. When we lived in Florence, the Kentucky side of the river and the Cincinnati side of the river both had floating restaurants that were, you know, you park and went across the gangplank onto this old boat that they turned the restaurant. You could look down into the Ohio River as you were going across the gangplank. What you would see in that water, I couldn't believe why people were boating on it and skiing on it, because it looked like it would be the type of water that would put your foot in and you pull it out and you'd miss it. But back when Daniel Boone and those people first came, they could actually drink out of it. But now it's polluted. Our inheritance can't be polluted. It can't be defiled. It's perfect. The word fade means to be perpetual. This inheritance will not fade. It means it will have no change or decay. The things of this earth change and decay constantly. But not this inheritance that comes from that Easter hope, that living hope that Jesus Christ has won for us. The word kept means to set something aside. It means to keep an eye on it. It means to guard it from loss. So this is an inheritance we cannot lose. Now, in my family, we had an unfortunate experience with an inheritance. Some of you may be familiar, you may have had something like this happen in your family somewhere along the line, or know somebody. But when 1998, when my grandmother, my mother's mother, died at 101 years old, and after her will went through probate court and all that, and the judge was ready to enforce my grandmother's will, one of my cousins, the grandson of my grandmother, was the son of my mother's brother, only brother, older brother. She had two older sisters and brothers. She was a baby in the family. Well, this cousin of mine sued the estate, saying that he was entitled to money that was not listed for him in the will because of his dad having been the only son of my grandfather, and that my grandfather supposedly gave everything to my grandmother and to his dad. And unfortunately, my uncle was kind of the typical son that you see in old movies and William Faulkner stories and other southern stories. My grandfather was a big man, bigger than myself, very successful. Everything he touched was a success. When he died, my grandmother and the son took over everything. My uncle took over neighborhood taverns, ends up getting burned in a fire almost. 80% of his body, they didn't think he was going to live, and he survived. End up living the rest of his life with my grandmother, living off my grandmother, like she said, his inheritance. She bought him a new car for so many years, gave him money to go off and borrow and buy his buddy's drugs, put him through real estate school. He even had his gold jacket with the Century 21 and gold, and then lights right on. Come home, and he'd have a ceramic, purchase a ceramic German Shepherd and put in the front door and the window of the front door so people would be scared off thinking it was a real German Shepherd. Bought two pictures, some water paintings of the Secretariat and River Ridge. It just wasted his money. My kids, our kid, Gene and I, had boys visiting more than his own grandchildren. And yet this cousin, then, when my grandmother died, sued. Of course, my mother had to get a lawyer, and the lawyer told her that the only people who were going to make money would be the lawyers. And that's what happened. Because the judge in the case ruled the will void and put everything up to public auction. My grandma's house, everything, so we had nothing. And there were books my grandma wanted me to have that she had in her house. There were different trophies from when my mother was little, and they were raced towards thoroughbreds across the country. Silverware, all this kind of thing went to strangers and went out to the dump. All because this cousin thinking he deserved more than what the will had said. So earthly inheritance can be destroyed. But this living inheritance, this living hope, it cannot be. Because God keeps his eye on it. He guards it from loss. He sets it aside. And then what St. Peter is telling us in verse 5 is that this hope is protected by God. In verse 5, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed at the last time. Who by God's power, that means God's mighty acts, God's miracle, the creative power of God, all the power of God, this is guarded by. The word guarded means to watch. To man a guard, to garrison troops. It's the imagery of a location. For those of you who are in the military, probably experienced it. It is a description of a location that's very important. And so you garrison troops that are protected from the enemy, so the enemy can't get away. Well, God is like a whole army guarding this hope, guarding this inheritance. Salvation means our deliverance. So God's mighty acts mounts a guard over our salvation, our deliverance, and is ready to reveal at the last time. This means when Jesus comes again, then God will be ready to reveal those things that he didn't reveal during Jesus' earthly ministry. The word literally means to take a lid off something, or to remove a veil, or disclose something. And we lived on my grandmother's farm with her. She liked to cook a lot of things on the stove, either in a pressure cooker or pot with a lid on it. So sometimes I'd come in the kitchen from having to work outside in the fields or cutting grass or cutting down corn stalks or something, and there were these pots with the lids on them. So I'd lift them up to see what they were having for supper. Because sometimes the smell's all on her neck, so I couldn't tell what exactly we were having. When the pressure cooker was on and we had ham earlier in the week, I knew what was in the pressure cooker. I didn't have to look. I knew it was going to be meat soup. So I knew that was going to be a meal I wasn't going to enjoy. But this word is describing it, taking a lid off something, see what's in it, to remove a veil. Remember the temple. The Holy of Holies had a veil that went from the ceiling to the floor, and only one time a year could anybody go beyond that veil to the Holy of Holies, and that was the high priest on the Day of Atonement. And we're told that on that first Good Friday, when Jesus said, "It is finished," and then said, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit," and bowed his head and gave the spirit back to God, and all that darkness was around, and then the soon as Jesus gave his spirit back to God, the veil of the temple ripped from top to bottom, totally in two, signifying that with Jesus' death, now we would be able to talk to God directly, that we wouldn't need a high priest anymore. We wouldn't need a day of atonement. That any time we want, we can pray to God and ask him for mercy. We can pray to God and ask him for forgiveness. We can pray to God and ask him for guidance. So when Jesus comes again, then everything will be revealed. As I've said before, we don't have a whole lot of descriptions about heaven. The book of Revelation gives us some insight. Jesus, through some of his parables, gives us some insight. Some of his words that he told us. But we don't have a complete picture. Well, on the day of his return, then everything will be made known. We'll see heaven. We'll see all of what God intended. And so all of this is this living hope that we receive because Jesus is risen and alive. All of this is a gift for us out of God's great mercy and compassion because of our faith in his Son, Jesus Christ, whom he sent into this world because he loved the world so much that he gave his only Son so that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. So because Jesus is risen and alive, we are born to a living hope. We receive a hope that is an inheritance which never spoils, never perishes, or fades away. And we receive this hope that is protected by God. We receive all of this because God loves us and wants us to be with him forever. So indeed, we speak well of God and speak well of this wonderful gift given to us through faith in his risen and alive Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. We will now sing I Love to Tell the Story, hymn number 661, in the back of your worship. Hymn number 661.
Was written by Catherine Hankey, who lived 1834 to 1911. Wonderful female hymn writer. I love to tell the story. Catherine Hankey.
Thank you.
in the front of your worship book. Again, I invite those who can do so without difficulty to please stand. With the whole church, let us confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated.
Time for our offering. As you see the gifts, the ushers will come forth, and the gifts will be received. We have sung this wonderful hymn written by Catherine Hankey. I will sing the wondrous story. It's a witness, song of witnessing. Catherine Hankey was a contemporary of Wilberforce, and she believed very strongly in abolition of slavery. Also, Catherine Hankey was in favor of missions, and one of her brothers was a famous missionary, Catherine Hankey. I will sing the wondrous story as Jesus has given us the Great Commission. Go into all the world and preach the gospel. Today we have our lesson on that we will believe in Jesus Christ. Even if we don't see him, we don't have to see him the way that Thomas did. That we believe in faith. We know that Jesus died. We have the witnesses who tell us that, and we believe them. Jesus gives us our inheritance. We are the children of God. We have our Holy Communion celebrated the first and third Sunday in each month, festivals, and every Wednesday evening. Watch our Sunday services on YouTube or Google, and in St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is the second Sunday of Easter, April 23rd, 2017. We invite you to come to our services. We have services at 8 o'clock every Sunday. We receive Holy Communion. We receive the bread of heaven. We receive a taste of heaven. And this keeps us going. Jesus Christ is with us every day. We have eternal life.
Be present with all who suffer abuse, the addiction or illness, and grant them your mercy and comfort. God of new life,
hear our prayer.
Source of every blessing, you call your people to serve those who are poor and in need. Use the gifts of this congregation to feed the hungry, clothe the naked, minister to the sick, and witness to your abundant grace. God of new life,
hear our prayer.
Comforting God, you raised your Son so we might have eternal life. We praise you for the witness of the faithful who have died. Bring us at last to share with them in eternity with you. God of new life,
hear our prayer.
With heaven and earth and all creation, we offer our prayers in the name of the one who conquered death to give us eternal life and joy, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For that is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. May the Almighty and merciful God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit bless, comfort, strengthen, and keep us, now and forever. Amen. We conclude our worship with our Sing the Wondrous Song, which is on the back cover of the book.
This hymn, I Will Sing the Wondrous Story, was written by Dr. Francis Rowley, a minister in the Baptist Church. He was also head of who founded the Society of Prevention of Cruelty to Animals. He's famous for that. I Will Sing the Wondrous Story. And he loved animals too, as he loved the story of God. It's Christ who died for us, left his home in glory for the cross of Calvary. This is written by Francis Rowley, Baptist minister, founder of the SPCA.
Thank you.
watching us on YouTube, we've heard today that we have the hope of salvation. We have the assurance of salvation, that God has granted us inheritance through Jesus' death, and he has angels, he has troops, he has people who have gone before us, all together with us. The flowers and the chancel stands are to the glory of God today, presented by Ted and Helen Wallace in memory of Ted's father's birthday. Flowers also given by Pastor and Gina in the memory of the death of Gina's father, Ray Schwartz, and in memory of the birthday of Gina's brother, Robert Schwartz. Gina was a Schwartz before she married Pastor Pollock, and these are memories of the Schwartz and in honor of the birthday of her brother, Robert Schwartz. We invite you to come to St. John's Church, receive the Holy Spirit. The sacraments today, we had the service of the Word. Jesus gives us Word and sacrament. He gives us his Word that when he died on the cross, he said, into your hands, God, I commend my spirit. And that's what happens to us. We commend our spirits go, our souls go to be with God at the time of death, and then our body will be risen at the last day. Jesus' body changed to an incorruptible body, incorruptible, resurrected body, still kept his wounds, so we'd be reminded of what happened to him who died on the cross to save us. Mrs. Thomas saw the wounds and he knew, and Thomas died a martyr in India after this experience. He founded a church in India and died a martyr in India. We invite you to come, 8 o'clock service, 10:30 service, times of Holy Communion. We celebrate the first and third Sunday of each month, festivals, and every Wednesday evening. So we invite you to come 8 o'clock Sunday morning, 10:30 Sunday morning, 9:15 Sunday school, 10:30 in the chapel, and receive Holy Communion, true body and true blood of Jesus Christ. When you receive Holy Communion, you can pray that you can feel the presence of Jesus, a warm feeling or a tingling feeling. Sometimes it's emotional, sometimes not. You can ask for this, sometimes God grants it. Continue to ask him and he will grant it. He will grant this feeling of his presence and he'll be with you forever. We know that he is with us. His presence here now, he's in the tabernacle. The veil of the temple is rent and he is with us forever. Jesus Christ has given us eternal life. And he is with us forever, every minute of every day. We have the food of angels, food of heaven, panis angelicus, the bread of angels. We receive this in Holy Communion. We invite you, we bless you, we pray for you and pray for us in our ministry, that we have more people. And as you're watching this, please take it to somebody else and let them see it. Let them see the service. Let them see this on YouTube.